Hello, it is time for COM 340, Rhetoric and Popular Culture, and today we're going to talk about a rhetoric of spectacle. We're going to talk a little bit about the carnivalesque. It's a useful analytical tool because it allows us to organize artifacts and think about them that don't really fit anywhere else, and that can be a little bit more difficult to place. It's a very peculiar kind of artifact, and it functions very closely to how we discussed horror working, but with some very specific differences. So we will discuss the carnivalesque and look at some examples and make sure that our understanding is shored up before we go forward. So first, we'll watch together this video because it's brief and is honestly a decent explanation of the carnivalesque.
Carnivalesque is a term that describes the subversion and liberation of a dominant culture through humor and chaos. This term was coined by Mikhail Bakhtin, a Russian linguist, who used the term for writings that depicted carnivalesque themes. It was important for Bakhtin's use of the word that the writings didn't just talk about carnivalesque themes, but also the writings themselves were carnivalesque in the way they were written. Originally used to describe writings, this term has now come to be applied to multiple forms of media. Carnivalesque elements can be identified through its many themes, and one of them is celebrating grotesqueness. The Joker from The Dark Knight is a character that celebrates the grotesque in life. He paints his face to emphasize the scars on his cheeks, and he enjoys the brutal and violent way he treats people. In the same way that the Joker celebrates being grotesque, God is a Woman by Ariana Grande celebrates sexuality. The song discusses the sexual liberation of females and how that can empower them, and the music video enhances this message through images of Grande acting as powerful male figures in history, thus reversing the usual gender roles we see in modern day. Emphasis on sexuality and role reversals are common themes associated with carnivalesque media and celebrations. Back in the 17th century, people would reverse roles with authority during celebrations to mock them. Now in today's society, we still mock authority but have fun doing it as well. One of the last elements to carnivalesque is animism or magic. Magic started to infuse everyday life when carnivalesque events became prevalent. Even now, magic has a part in modern media. The film Coco is about a popular celebration in Mexican culture, Dia de los Muertos. The film shows the traditions associated with this celebration and how it revolves around magical thinking, a main theme of carnivalesque celebrations. Elements of carnival continue to infuse everyday life and will continue to do so as long as we keep wanting to be individuals.
All right, thank you, YouTube video. So here's a quotation, a definition of the carnivalesque that I think is extremely helpful in laying out some of the basics that a carnivalesque text, a carnivalesque artifact sort of does and how it functions. And it also will provide sort of a roadmap for us to apply the carnivalesque as a model to an artifact in order to be able to understand it in the way that the carnivalesque prescribes. So the carnival is a world of ambivalent festive laughter, which brings together oppositions, sublimates death, and dispels the fear of death. So essentially, the carnival is a world where we've got some, it's about fun, right? And it's about mocking the things that potentially have power over us, the authorities, things that determine the rules. So when we're looking back at the 17th century, that's going to be things like the monarchy and the church, giving yourself a chance to mock those things and not fear for your life. Basically like a release valve for society where the people who are oppressed can mock those that oppress them. And these kinds of festivals happen in basically every culture, essentially. And it's not just mocking the things that control life in that sort of material sense, but also things like death and the supernatural. It's about laughing at these things. And I want to pull your attention to specifically the word ambivalent there. You might remember the prefix ambi, as in ambidextrous, meaning you can use both hands. It sort of means in the middle. So benevolent means good, like for the good. Malevolent means for the bad. Ambivalent means it's not really good or bad. It's just sort of in the middle. And for the carnivalesque, that means that the laughing that we're doing, it's not comedy, but it's not mean-spirited either. So it's sort of like in the middle. So we've got those oppositions being brought together. The things that are on top are now on bottom. And we want to look at the things that threaten us, be they our own fears or anxieties, sort of the ever-present specter of death. The carnivalesque engages those things and allows us insight into what they are. But it also has some very specific rules. So let's take a look at some examples of the carnivalesque doing exactly this, providing a way to subvert some taboo subjects in order to explore them or experience them or even celebrate them. First up, we have this clip from Jackass 3.
Hello. Hello, my name is Johnny Knoxville. We have professional football players, Eric Gange, Jared Allen, and our referee today, Sean Williams Scott. This is The Blind Side. I didn't do it, wee man. I didn't do it. Jack, why did you do that?
I feel like I lost the moment.
Let's get this shit over with. You just planted me in the fucking ground. That felt like shit. Have you ever played linebacker before?
Years and years ago.
You think you can give it a try?
Quickly review. What's your job?
Murder Knoxville's face.
What's your job?
Catch the ball.
Do this.
I mean, catch the ball.
You think Knoxville's gonna catch the ball?
Nope.
Give the shit. Hey, Jared, don't hit me with your purse this time.
Nice wristband, douche.
Catching.
People don't realize football is a game of physics. Speed and velocity equals that.
Good game.
Good game.
See you in the shower.
See you in the shower.
Yeah,
all right.
See you in the shower. Oh, fuck.
Okay. So there we have a pretty excellent example of the carnivalesque. And it's one of the more popular examples of the carnivalesque, especially contemporarily. But the reason it counts as a carnivalesque is precisely the way that it's set up. So this is a bit where Johnny Knoxville is just basically getting hit very hard for us to laugh at, right? Like it's a comedian, sort of like person off the street, being demolished by a professional football player. And the reason this fits into the carnivalesque is because, well, one, you hear the participants, the people filming it, laughing, and it's sort of sold to us as a comedy. So we know that there's a mocking, lighthearted tone involved. But also, it's smashing together opposites. When you're playing football, you're trying to avoid getting hit that way, especially with what we know about the sport and its lasting impacts. We want to try to minimize those big hits to preserve the health of the players who are making their living playing the game. But here, the violence is the point. And not just the point, but it's the source of the humor. The things that you typically try to avoid, the pain, is the source of the laughter. And so it's basically flipped that on its head. At the same time, they're also joking around with a situation that could be extremely dangerous. Hits like that can end people's careers and have lifelong health impacts. And this sketch treats it like a joke. And so the carnivalesque is certainly at play here. They're also wearing costumes, dressed up in football uniforms and referee uniforms. The carnivalesque likes costumes and dressing up as well. We'll see that when we get to the tenets. Next, let's check out this Key and Peele sketch and see the ways in which it is carnivalesque.
Redneck wants us to move into his community. Us? Let's go.
You guys showed up. I gotta get out of here. It's a silver Lexus. Just pull it right up front and don't scuff the paint, all right? I just had it buffed.
Okay. So for this sketch, it's carnivalesque in the way that it's doing a couple of things. First, whereas the Jackass sketch maybe gives us a chance to talk about the dangers of football or taking hits, potentially, right? This Key and Peele sketch is much more upfront with the sort of taboo subject that it's allowing us to discuss with its approach, and that is racism and the tropes associated with racism and racist beliefs. So by sort of working their way through these stereotypical, like, racist tropes, it's allowing us to sort of think about them and giving us that pressure valve, that release from living in a world where they're so prevalent, by exploring it in such an absurd way, right? By putting the not only the characters in danger in the sketch, but the entire world. It's an alien invasion. And they are deciding sort of who lives and who dies based on these, like we said, racist stereotypes or stereotypes of racist beliefs. So this is carnivalesque because we're absolutely putting together oppositions, right? These characters have the power to decide who lives and who dies, where typically ideology and the social institutions that we have in place are doing that. So that's sort of turned on its head. And it's also giving us a chance to literally laugh at these aliens and then at the end of that person being killed and being shot. This is sort of an inherently violent sketch, but because it's firmly planted in the carnivalesque and gives us a chance to think about and discuss a taboo subject, we can sort of not pay attention to the violence, or at least watching the sketch, what you get from it, the point of it is not the violence. And so let's look at some other aspects of the carnivalesque, specifically the aspects that align with horror and then a little bit different with horror. As we mentioned in our lecture about horror as a genre, it also gives us a chance to explore taboo subjects, right? To think about them, to engage with them in a way that we wouldn't get otherwise if we didn't have the disguise or the framing that is the horror genre around it. Here, the carnivalesque works in a very similar way, but there is a big difference. What is that difference? It's the ambivalent laughter. It's that mocking tone. So while horror and comedy can and do cross paths quite a bit, just because a horror has some jokes in it doesn't automatically make it carnivalesque. Carnivalesque, the point is to laugh, to celebrate, to have fun, to make fun of ideas. And while something can both be firmly implanted in the horror genre and also be an example of something that's carnivalesque, it doesn't have to be. So horror can be funny without being carnivalesque, but the carnivalesque is always going to have some sort of humor element with it. So let's look at the key concepts. Here are the tenets, or in other words, basically the check marks, the checkpoints for trying to decide if an artifact counts as being carnivalesque or not. The first thing, of course, is laughter that we discussed. It's the big difference between the carnivalesque and horror. Contradiction, or this putting together of opposites, making something the case is not usually the case. We want that reversal. That's very important. Costumes, they speak to that sort of grotesqueness of the carnivalesque. And grotesque doesn't have to mean disgusting. We sort of allow the connotation to go there, but just over the top, exaggerated. And costumes are, in most cases, the way that the carnivalesque becomes exaggerated or over the top. With the Jackass sketch, it's that they're dressed as football players when they're not doing football, right? They're literally just hitting each other, and you can wear all sorts of different pads for that. And in Key and Peele, of course, the grotesqueness happens with, you know, the effects, the green blood, things like that. We also have mockery. So it's not just that laughing is happening, but the specific kind of laughter. We're making fun of ideas and situations that we'd typically be afraid of or much more concerned over. And so underlying the carnivalesque, we have the mocking of death and also the mocking of fear. So the idea that you could die and would be worried about it, or that we were afraid of things, are sort of on the table to be made fun of by artifacts deemed to be participating in the carnivalesque in this rhetorical mode. We'll leave with one last example here, and it's a trailer for a film that came out in the late 80s and spawned a sequel, was popular enough to spawn a sequel, but is absurd, the kind of movie that really could have only been made in the late 80s, early 90s. But we'll watch it and then discuss why it is a good example of the carnivalesque.
Don't you see? We just uncovered a $2 million error. We're going to be heroes. We're going up the corporate ladder. It appears as if somebody's trying to defraud the company.
Somebody tried to smoke it past the wrong guy.
Very, very good work. How would you two like to come to my house at the beach?
Love to.
For Larry and Richard.
How are you?
This is a place to die for.
You have to kill them, Vito.
I'm a little rusty. It'll come back to me.
What? Should we just walk in?
But what they don't realize.
No, we'll stand out here on weekend. Come on, we're house guests.
Is while they're checking in.
Forget the accident with the two guys.
to Carol Lomax.
Bernie Lomax will be checking out.
Oh, my God. What kind of a host invites you to his house for the weekend and dies on you?
I don't know.
Lomax told whoever he's talking to not to kill us if he's around, right?
Yeah, yeah, but Lomax is dead. He's not around anybody anymore.
I know that. You know that. Nobody else knows that.
Huh? Oh! Where's Bernie? It looks good enough. Let's go.
Uh-oh.
Larry, what?
Huh?
Oh.
Really?
Hi, Bernie. Hey, Bernie, just like last week, huh?
Oh, Bernie, you animal. You are insatiable.
Doesn't anyone realize he's dead?
Blow the ball.
Got it?
Lomax is alive. Maybe Paulie is rustier than we thought.
Ooh, Bernie, you're starting to peel. I'm getting you out of sun, huh? Is that the killer? How do I know, Richard? Should I stop and ask you?
No,
just drive.
Ladies and gentlemen, Weekend at Bernie's, right? An excellent example of the carnivalesque. We have sort of the grotesqueness of the situation as it is. We have this odd impulse to pretend like someone who has died is alive. We're very much mocking death and our attitudes towards death. They're very clearly desecrating a corpse, which is a crime. And it's all being played for laughs. We're sort of making fun of the idea that you shouldn't, you know, do these things. It's all being played for a joke, to the point where they're literally dragging the corpse on the water and it banging against these sort of metal buoys is played for laughs. And we know that it's supposed to be funny because did you hear the music playing, right? Some like it hot. It's nothing about the trailer is telling us to take this seriously or that what's happening has any sort of grave consequences. And so does it allow us to actually engage in a taboo? Well, it allows us to think about our bodies after we are no longer inhabiting them, whatever that might mean. And so it at least confronts us with the idea and the notion of death that we don't typically engage with, specifically what happens to us after we die in a very physical, material sense. So it's an example of the carnivalesque. And because of that, we get insight into the taboo things that it allows us to explore. That's the benefit of something being in the carnivalesque and us making an argument for it, is that if it fits, then we get the advantages of the mode. Then we get to make more compelling and interesting arguments. Okay, so that is the carnivalesque. We'll discuss more as we continue on. Thank you very much.